Welcome to the video lesson 13, the last stone mason of secondary level English. Learners, most of our art, culture and traditions have been our identity since the ancient times and are dying out. Our traditional arts and crafts, which are an important part of our culture and heritage, are losing shine. Why are these traditional arts dying out? Maybe it is because the handicrafts trade does not fetch much money. Artisans struggle hard to make both ends meet. They don't have adequate material to make their products. They need markets to sell their products, but there is not much demand for their products. Young artisans want to earn more money and are in favor of mass production of items that can be produced quicker than by hand. This makes them leave their family handicraft industry. Should they do this? Should we let our traditional arts and crafts die out? Can we do anything to stop it? Reasons are many. Many of these traditions and crafts were legacies of families which took pride in their handiwork, were handed over from parents to children. But now most of the children do not want to follow the footsteps of their fathers. Handicrafts do not have a big market. Handmade products are costlier than those produced on a mass scale, which work out cheaper. Each piece takes a long time to produce. And even then, the artisans do not fetch much money sometimes, as it is difficult for them to make two ends meet. In such a situation, their families' health and education suffer. No wonder the generation doesn't want to follow the family art tradition. Merely sticking to one value, family pride and expertise, may not take them too far in their life. Children have their own aspirations and would pursue those rather than live in squalor and poverty. There are many other reasons, such as no proper market for them or a medium to promote their crafts, which demoralizes them. Above all, the lesson throws up crucial question of generation gap. The new generation has a mind of its own. For them, success and money are more valuable than abstract philosophy of service to God. Learners, coming to the objectives of the lesson, after completing this lesson, you will be able to explain the theme of the story, analyze the character of the father in the story, explain the importance of cooperation and understanding among the members of a family through effective communication, deduce that the urge to learn helps in mastering a skill, justify your point of view, whether you agree or disagree, enhance your vocabulary, identify the different functions of verbs ending with ing, use the present perfect tense, use adverbs of manner and write a report. Learners, coming to the gist of the lesson, this is a story of an old stone mason who made beautiful artifacts and statues. He is totally committed and devoted to his art. He has financial difficulties, but those do not trouble him when he is busy sculpting a statue. He was keen that his son learn the art and keep the tradition of his ancestors alive. But the son rebels. He is not interested. He throws the hammer and the chisel down and announces that he is leaving. He yelled out that he was leaving his father and his work. He points out to the dark and dingy room, stacked up with stone and marble and scraps of whitewashed wall coming off, and asks whether this was what his profession had given him in return for his labor. The old man is shocked to hear his son's outburst. He tells him that it is not money that one should be hankering after. One must keep one's values intact. They were doing a great service to God. The son tells him that times have changed and that this was an era of mass production. He would much rather sell candle stands and paperweights to tourists at Agra rather than slog carving statues for temples. After the son left, the old man went into a stupor. He was old and tired and did not know how to finish the statue of Radha and Krishna that he was carving. Just then Salim, an orphan boy who used to serve him, gave him tea and revived his spirits. The old man tells him that soon he would be the last stone mason left in this world. All others had gone to Agra to sell machine carved items. But he was determined to finish the piece he had at hand. Did he finally finish the statue? And how? Learners, Read the lesson to find out the answer. Read the story, The Last Stone Mason, on your own. Did you get the answer? Learners, let's read part one of the story from the lines, The young man, two, he sat still. This part of the story deals with differences between the old generation and the new. It is about generation gap. The stonemason represents old value and old customs. He is sculptor. He had inherited the art and skill from his father and forefathers. He was keen to pass the legacy down to his son. He is very poor and old and lives in a dingy hut, but that does not bother him. His spirits are elevated by his thoughts process. He enjoys his job thoroughly and feels money cannot buy him the satisfaction that he gets by serving God. This is because he makes statues of gods and goddesses. His son doesn't want to follow his footsteps. His outlook is different. He wants to go to a bustling city like Agra, where he can sell machine-made artifacts in hundreds to tourists and make money. The son sees more value in money and live a life of comfort rather than slog in a dark but hammering and chiseling at stone each day and yet turn out a product after days of labor. The father and son have an argument. Father wants his son to help him complete the statue. He feels to by doing so, he will be serving God. But the son rubbishes his philosophy and tries to put sense into him by telling him that after working so hard, what was his gain? He would much rather have his father see how much produced goods were selling like hotcakes and were money spinners. No amount of convincing could keep him back. The son left. The mason was shocked. He sat still in a trance, couldn't believe that he was serious about what he said. He looked at the half-finished statues of Radha and Krishna and wondered how he will complete it. He almost threw his hands in despair and sat still. Carving takes a long time. Now read the second part of the story, learners, part 13.2 from the lines, Masterji, 2, dropped to the ground and he fainted. This part of the story deals with the scene after the son left his father. The old man was in a state of shock. Just then, Salim, the orphan boy, entered with a cup of tea. His voice was that of concern. The old man looked at him. Salim saw he was very pale, old and tired. The old man said to him that soon he would be the last stone mason left. All others had gone to Agra and other cities. He looked at the half-finished sculpture of Radha and Krishna and muttered that now he will have to complete it on his own, with no one to give him a helping hand. He told the boy that now he did not have the strength as he used to have in his old days. He could not lift the hammer and chisel with the same strength as he used to. But he was determined to finish the piece at hand and emphatically said he would. With this resolve, the man worked at the statue day and night without taking any rest. His hands trembled and his shoulders ached. His eyes grew tired, but he worked with a single aim, that he must finish this statue. Finally, he realized that he couldn't see anymore. At that point of time, Salim returned. He asked the man to eat some food as he was very weak. The old man was so obsessed with the thought of completing the statue that he muttered only words like, "I'm not going to finish it. I will not complete it." He wished Gopal, his son, were there. Things would have been different. He could have banked on him to help him complete it. He told Salim that Gopal was not a good craftsman and could not chisel out fine features on the face and hands properly. There was something missing in his fingers and that something could not be taught. Salim pepped him up by telling that he drew his inspiration from his heart. His devotion was his inspiration and that kept him going. He told Salim that he was right in saying that unless you are passionate about doing something, you cannot do it perfectly. And then making a sarcastic remark for his son, he said, "When you don't have something in you, then people like him migrate to Agra to mass produce petty things like ashtrays and sell them to tourists." Here was an important point. The father made statues of gods and goddesses, which kept him elevated. In sharp contrast to this was the son, who was happy selling ashtrays so long as it fetched him money. Here, one pauses to ask, is living an impoverished life, but one which is full of devotion, is one's art more important than a desire to make more money, even if it meant earning by selling cheap and petty products? This is indeed the question which many of us face in society today. Spiritual value versus material value. What is more important? Salim made him eat food, so he felt little stronger. After that, the old man kept working till late night. These days, he used to pray a lot, but now his prayers were directed more towards his work. He prayed that he is able to finish his work. He also prayed for his son. He kept working, but towards morning, the chisel fell off from his hands and he fainted. What do you think? He prayed for his son. Surely, he must have prayed that his son realizes his mistake and returns home to carry the family tradition onwards. Otherwise, the art would die along with him. A passionate and devoted person thinks of a larger benefit to mankind rather than think him just for himself. A true artist thinks of posterity. Learners, now read 13.3 part of the story. When the old man opened his eyes to India will ever have. What do you think must have happened? Do you think the old man was able to complete the statue? Was he right in saying that with him the art would die, as there was no one left to pursue this art? Do you think Providence comes to the rescue of such spirited and devoted people? There was a surprise waiting for the old man. What do you think it was? Let us find out. When the old man opened his eyes, he saw he was lying in a cot and someone had covered him with a blanket. Then he heard a sound coming from the next room. Someone was hammering and chiseling the statues. He was surprised. Who could it be? Had he heard the sound correctly? He thought his son Gopal had returned. Maybe Gopal put some sense in him and brought him back. He is happy. At least now he'll be able to complete the statue. Still frail and weak from overwork, the old man walked up to the workshop. He was about to call out for Gopal. Then the words froze as what he saw. He saw a boy carving the face of the statue. At first, he wanted to shout, stop the work. But then he could not speak. He stood staring at the young stone carver carving the face on the statue. The young boy was not Gopal, but the young Salim, his servant. All the anger and the weakness vanished, and in its place, there was only admiration on the old man's face. He turned to Salim, put his hands on his shoulder and uttered, Salim. Salim was a bit uncomfortable at first, feeling rather guilty at being seen working on his favorite statue. Salim muttered, I only wanted to help. I will learn if you'll teach me. Then Salim confessed that for the last 2 years, he had been practicing secretly in the stone quarry without telling anyone. The old man was very touched. He embraced Salim and told him that there was nothing that he could teach him. He knew that he was doing it from his heart. He was now sure that he would prove to be best stonemason India will ever have. Learners, coming to the summary of the story gives us a glimpse of how and why our ancient crafts are on the verge of extinction. Most of the art forms are already extinct. Others are slowly dying. If nothing is done to preserve them, then they too will die. Why should we preserve these forms? We need to preserve them because they are part of our culture and our identity. If we lose our culture and identity, we are like homeless wanderers. This is a story about an old and poor stonemason who has learned this art from his father. It has come down to him in a form of legacy. And he is very proud to have learned this art. Stone sculpting is an arduous task and it takes a long time to complete one image. The stonemason was crafting statues of gods and goddesses for the temple. He is very devoted and passionate about his art. The profession does not give him much money. In fact, he is barely able to survive with the meager income he has. But he has no ambition or desire to leave the work and take up something more lucrative. He feels he is doing a great service to mankind by keeping the art alive. His son, who belongs to the great new generation, is unlike his father. He has no liking for the job. His heart is not there. So he is very clumsy and untidy with his sculpting. One day, when he couldn't suppress his feelings for too long, he threw the hammer and the chisel and told his father that he was not going to do it. He raises a fundamental question, learners. What has this job given you? With the meager money he gets, he is not able to live in a good hut or procure any comfort for himself and his family. He announces his plans to go to Agra, where he can sell machine-crafted collectibles to tourists and make much more money in a day than what his father earns. Gopal, the son, represents not just the modern generation, but also represents the consumerist era of mass production. Also, he is not emotionally attached to anything, and therefore he does not value those things that are abstract and meaningless. The father is shell-shocked. He goes into a trauma-like condition. Salim, an orphan boy, steps in and offers him help and tea. The man pours out his concern to him. He was old and weak and had to complete the statue of Radha and Krishna. How will he complete without help? All the artisans in the village had left for Agra, swept by the lure of money. His son could not do a fine job because his heart was not there. He worries what would happen to the art after he was no more. Perhaps he would be the last stone mason left when he dies. The stone sculpting would also come to an end. He is determined to complete the statue, so he works night and day to the point of overexerting himself. One day, he nearly fainted while working late night. Salim saw him and picked him up and put him on the bed. Salim had been secretly admiring the mason's work and had been quietly practicing in the quarry. Now, when he realized the pain and anguish of the old man, he decided to help him complete the statue. So he took the hammer and chisel and began to carve the face, which is the most intricate part of a statue. The old man woke up with a start. He heard the sound of hammering coming from the next room. At first, he thought Gopal, his son, had returned. He was happy. He walked slowly to the room and shocked to see Salim working at it. His first instinct was to tell him to stop because he was crafting the face part. The old man was not able to fathom how this orphan boy had picked up the art without any formal training. But he had worked from the heart, and anything done from the heart is perfect. The old man was happy. He hugged him and blessed him. He said he would become the best sculptor in the country. More than that, he was pleased that the art would perhaps live on. Learners, what we have learned from the story. Stone sculpting is an ancient art. The art is dying because no one cares for it anymore. Duplicates are being produced en masse, which are taking away the market of the artisans. In an era of mass production, producing a single handcrafted piece takes a very long time. Artisans are poor people because they cannot make enough to sell fast. Their families suffer and their children are more materialistic. They want to live better lives, which they know earning good money is important. There is a question of tradition, ethics and values versus materialistic outlook and consumerism. The new generation does not value home-crafted art pieces. The real artist is a dedicated man who dedicates his work to the Almighty and works with his heart and soul in it. He is so passionate about his art that he would not like it to die. Therefore, he wishes to pass on the legacy to his children. All is not lost, just as Salim came into the life of the old mason and showed promise of an expert craftsman. There will be people who will remain passionate about their art and will promote it or at least prevent it from dying. The question before us is whether we should preserve the art or be happy with duplicates and lookalikes. In case we want authentic handcrafted art pieces, we must support the artist by buying his things and ensure he earns enough to feed his family and take care of their needs. Learners, as I already told you, that inbuilt grammar portion is there in your lesson. Here in this lesson, there is present perfect tense. So, we'll deal that. You already know that tense is nothing but a verb indicating time of action. A present perfect tense is an action word which conveys a sense that the action was done in the present and has been completed by the time the utterance is made. Now, read some examples. So, in sentence number one, when I say, look what it has brought us, has brought is present perfect tense. In the second sentence, we have kept up the tradition. Have kept is present perfect tense. In the third sentence, I have learned this art from my father, or I have learned this from my father. So, have learned is present perfect tense. Did you also notice that the present perfect tense is preceded by an auxiliary verb, helping verb, I would say, has or have? The action in all these cases happened very recently in the past. Now, some more examples for you. India has won the cricket match against Sri Lanka. Has won. Learners, can you make some sentences of your own? Now, use of negatives. If we want to denote a negative action, we use not or never between the two verbs. For example, he has traveled all over India, but he has never gone abroad. Has traveled, present perfect. Has never gone, present perfect negative. I cannot accompany you because I have not finished my homework. Cannot accompany, have not finished. So, learners, did you notice the use of not and never in the examples? Now, do the exercise 1 given in your book and practice that. Learners, exercise 2, and that is about framing questions in the present perfect tense. Just as we denote a negative action by using not or never, we can frame questions using WH words. For example, where have you bought this car from? What has Ramesh given you for your birthday? Learners, do the exercise given in your book. There are some statements given. You have to frame questions for which these sentences are answers. Coming to the next grammar point, non-finites. We have read in one of our earlier lessons that each sentence has a subject and a predicate. The predicate begins with a finite verb. This verb not only denotes time, but is also governed by the subject. There are some examples. What happens when the subject is in the first, second or third person, singular or plural? You need to study some expressions. For example, I speak, you speak, she speaks, Hari speaks, we speak, they speak. An infinite verb plays a different role. It neither denotes time nor is it governed by the subject. For example, study the use of the swimming or to swim. For example, I like swimming, I like to swim, swimming is good for health, to swim in the morning is good for health, he likes swimming, he likes to swim, we like swimming, we like to swim, they like swimming, they like to swim. Most of the infinite verbs take an ing after them and take to form before it. Since these verbs are not governed by the subject and nor they indicate time, they are called infinite verbs. You need to complete the exercises given in the book and practice it. Third grammar point, adverbs of manner. Try to notice some sentences, learners. For example, he wondered if he had heard correctly. Next, weakly he walked to the door. I have been practicing secretly. Here, the words correctly, weakly, secretly all have ly as suffix attached at the end of a word. These words show how an action has been performed. So, they tell us something more about a verb, we call them adverbs. And because they tell us how the action is performed, we call them adverbs of manner. Learners, try to do the exercise 4 given in your book so that you can get a hang of adverbs of manner. Now, learners, coming to the vocabulary building section of the lesson, you want to improve your vocabulary, whether you are trying to strengthen and broaden your vocabulary for your personal growth. The key is a commitment to regularly learning new words. Why expand your knowledge and use of words? You will be able to communicate, speak and write more clearly and concisely. People will understand you more easily and you will increase the perception that you are an intelligent person. Besides learning new words is a fun activity and one you can even do with the people around you. Now, number one, read. The more you read, especially novels and literary works, but also magazines and newspapers, the more words you will be exposed to. As you read and uncover new words, use a combination of attempting to derive meaning from the context of the sentence as well as from looking up the definition in a dictionary. Keep a dictionary and thesaurus handy. Use whatever versions you prefer in print, software or online. When you uncover a new word, look it up in the dictionary to get both its pronunciation and its meaning. Use a journal. It's a good idea to keep a running list of the new words you discover so that you can refer back to the list and slowly build them into your everyday vocabulary. Plus, keeping a journal of your new words can provide positive reinforcement for learning even more words, especially when you see how many new words you have learned. Learners, try to learn a new word every day. Using a word a day calendar or website or developing your own list of words to learn is a great technique many people use to learn new words. This approach may be too rigid for some. So even if you do not or use this method, don't feel you must learn a new word every day. Go back to your roots, one of the most powerful tools for learning new words and for deciphering the meaning of other new words is studying Greek and Latin roots. Play some games, word games that challenge you and help you discover new meanings. And new words are a great and fun tool in your quest for expanding your vocabulary. Engage in conversations. Simply talking with other people can help you learn, discover new words. As with reading, once you hear a new word, remember to jot it down so that you can study it later. And then slowly add the new word to your vocabulary. Learners, final thoughts on improving and expanding your vocabulary. You hold the key to a better vocabulary by using the tips outlined in this very lecture of mine. You should be able to discover and learn new words to expand your vocabulary and strengthen your use of English language. Finally, remember that you must practice putting your new words into your writing and speaking and risk not retaining them into your brain. Use repetition exercises when you first learn a new word and consider other learning techniques such as index cards, recording yourself, reciting your words, association games, etc. Learners, there is a report writing section in the book that is inclusive of this lesson. Learners, a report is a systematic, well-organized document which defines and analyzes a subject or problem and which may include the record of a sequence of events, interpretation of the significance of these events or facts, evaluation of the facts or results of research presented, discussion of the outcomes of a decision or course of action, conclusions, recommendations. Learners, reports must always be accurate, concise, clear, well-structured. Learners, various courses require you to write reports, notably business and scientific or technical subjects. There are, however, different interpretations of what a report should look like. So it is important that you check with your course tutors or anyone who knows how to write a report regarding its format and content. In addition, there are times when some when there is a blur between essays, reports and assignments. Report writing, formatting the report elements. Learners, first of all, there is a title section. If the report is short, the front cover can include any information that you feel is necessary, including the authors and the date prepared. If a longer report is there, you may want to include a table of contents and a definition of terms. Coming to the summary, there needs to be a summary of the major points, conclusion and recommendations. It needs to be short as it is a general overview of the report. Some people will read the summary and only skim the report. So make sure you include all the relevant information. It would be best to write this last. So you will include everything, even the points that might be added at the last minute. Coming to introduction, the first page of the report needs to have an introduction. You will explain the problem and show the reader why the report is being made. You need to give a definition of terms if you did not include these in the title section and explain how the details of the report are arranged. Body. This is the main section of the report. The previous sections needed to be written in plain English, but this section can include jargon from your industry. There needs to be several sections, with each having a subtitle. Information is usually arranged in order of importance, with the most information coming first. Coming to conclusion, this is where everything comes together. Keep the section free of jargon, as most people will read the summary and conclusion. Coming to the recommendation, this is what needs to be done. In plain English, explain your recommendations, putting them in order of priority. Appendices. This includes information that the experts in the field will read. It has all the technical details that support your conclusions. The report writing format will make it easier for the reader to find what he is looking for. Remember to write all the sections in plain English except for body. Also remember that information needs to be organized logically, with the most important information coming first. Learners, tips for good writing. Learners, try to keep it simple. Do not try to impress, rather try to communicate. Keep the sentences short and to the point. Do not go into the lot of details unless it is needed. Make sure every word needs to be there, that it contributes to the purpose of the report. Use an active voice rather than passive. Active voice makes the writing move smoothly and easily. It also uses fewer words than the passive voice and gives impact to the writing by emphasizing the person or thing responsibly for an action. Good grammar and punctuation is important. Having someone proofread is a good idea. Remember that the computer cannot catch all the mistakes, especially with words like read, read, or there, or many others. Coming to the communication skills, there is a growing consensus among business executives or any firm that there is a lack of good writing skills among job applicants, as reported in several recent surveys. Some even ask for sample report when screening applicants. It is even included in the job description that the job requires a motivated communicator. Good communication is essential in any work. Usually, there is more than one individual that is working on a goal, and good communication will allow an exchange of ideas and concerns. There can be no team effort without communication, as it is necessary to coordinate the efforts of everyone. Remember, learners, bad communication can waste valuable time and effort. You need to check something very carefully. Carefully checking of your report before you print off the final version can make big difference. You need to check general layout, text organization, coherence, grammar, spelling and punctuation, referencing, style. And finally, overall, you need to think about the report's fulfillment of purpose. Does it do what you are being asked to do and what you say you are going to do in your introduction? Are you pleased with it? If you can't confidently answer yes to these questions, then you may need to do some more editing and rewriting. Learners, I hope you have understood the lesson well and have been able to interpret some of the key issues raised in it. Learners, remember, each lesson demands your undivided attention, as it has not only a story or any issue raised, it has inbuilt grammar and other skills which you need to understand well enough to write your exams. please look up the book of secondary level English of NIOS before writing your exams. Prepare well for your exams and best of luck. Thanks.